you might be able to see one great all-round cricketer. Well, I've been watching for a long time now, and over the past 18 years, I've been fortunate enough to see four great all-rounders in world cricket. There's Imran Khan of Pakistan and Kapil Dev of India, there's Ian Botham of England, and there's Sir Richard Hadlee of New Zealand, honoured by Her Majesty the Queen in 1990 for his services to New Zealand cricket and to cricket in general. He's the subject of this video, and it's a long time since you walked onto the Old Basin Reserve in 1972.
It is indeed, Richie, and I remember it very well.
It's a changed ground, and it must take you back from the moment when you walked off the field the other day at Edgbaston, the last time, to the days when you were a sprawly youngster running in absolutely flat out and hurling it down rather than bowling with finesse.
Well, of course, when you're a youngster, you're very keen, you're enthusiastic, and you get given your first chance and you want to impress and you want to do well. And the thing is, you don't know a lot about it either. And I remember the first ball that I bowled in Test cricket, and that was a full toss on the leg stump to Sadiq Mohammed. But I bowled the first ball of the Test match in general, and he got whipped away behind square for four runs. So that was my introduction to Test cricket. The same as I remember my last ball in Test cricket, which happened to be a wicket, the dismissal of Devon Malcolm, of course. But I go back to 1971-72 when I bowled my first ball in first-class cricket playing for Canterbury against Auckland. And again, it was a full toss to Terry Jarvis, and it got driven straight back past me to the boundary for four. So I guess it just sort of shows that whilst there's been a lot of successes, there've been a lot of mediocre performances as well, which sort of levels you considerably and tells you that you've got to work hard to get to the top, if not stay at the top. And I must say, in the early days, there was some pretty mixed and erratic, inconsistent performances.
I was there with that marvellous contest at Trent Bridge when Bevan Congdon and Vic Pollard almost did it. Not very far off, were they?
Well, that was an amazing Test match. I played in that first one. In fact, I was very lucky to gain selection in it because we went in with four seam bowlers or four quick bowlers. And so I played there and didn't get any wickets in the first innings and snared one in the second, John Snow, later in the match. An incredible Test match because, you know, we bowled England out for around about 250, which is a very good performance. And then we ourselves got bowled out for 97, which was quite unbelievable. In fact, the weather conditions changed considerably. It was very cloudy and overcast when we happened to bat, and the ball moved around considerably with John Snow and Jeff Arnold doing most of the damage there. And then we had him in trouble in the second innings. We had him 20-odd for four, and then Dennis Amos and Tony Gregg got 130-odd apiece. And we were left with the mammoth task of scoring, 479, 480 to win. And I also remember on the third day that members of the media actually checked out of the hotel, the Bridgeford Hotel, thinking the game would be over on the fourth day. And at the end of the fourth day, they had to check back in again to the hotel because we made an incredible assault on that particular target. And we eventually got bowled out for 440, I think it was.
Once again, off the bat foot, beautifully plays through the offside. That's four more. Fine shot. Used his feet right to the pitch of the ball. Driven firmly through mid-on for four.
That's it. And a fine innings from Congdon. Boycott is the fieldsman. Coming away out to deep mid on, and it's Bevan Congdon's 100. He goes on to 101 now. It's his fourth century in Test cricket. It's taken him 218 minutes, and he's hit 13 boundaries. It's a lovely shot. Boycott won't cut that off. It's four runs. Nice footwork there by Bevan Congdon. And it's his 14th boundary. And that's a fine shot too. And that may well signal the end of Norman Gifford's spell of slow medium pace left arm bowling.
Up and over the top, it's in the air. Is it going to be safe? Lewis is coming round, he's under it, but oh dear. Never got a hand to it. I rather fancy it went through his hands. It's gone for four.
Tony Lewis as the fieldsman, no chance of cutting that off. It was a flashing attempted square cut that flew off the top edge over gully. That's a good shot. That really is a nice, authentic forcing shot through cover point of the back foot.
This time off the back foot, a little squarer by Pollard. Plenty of time to come back for the second run. And that second run bringing up the 300 here. Well, it's taken 443 minutes to come up, but really a truly wonderful achievement, this. And it's it. Bowled him. Jeff Arnold's broken this partnership. So when England had just about given up hope of ever getting another wicket, I fancy, they've got the one they wanted most of all.
Roop, it's a good catch. My word, he's a good slip field, this fellow.
And that's out. And that's the wicket that they've waited such a very, very long time for. Asking again, he's given him this time. And Taylor not terribly happy about it, looking at the umpire, looking at his feet, looking back at the wicket.
And it's out. The bail is off. And the batsman is floored. Bowl him, the end of the test match. England winning by 39 runs, a famous victory. A magnificent test match.
And we missed out by 30 or 40 runs, but really it was a heroic attempt by New Zealand against the odds, and Bevan Congdon, of course, scored a magnificent 176. And I've always felt that the 73 team that I played in was probably the best New Zealand side I played in as far as all-round ability was concerned, because there was Glenn Turner, of course, Congdon himself. I don't think there's been another New Zealand side that's actually matched it as far as all-round skill and ability is concerned, although, of course, in recent times, the New Zealand side performed a lot better than it did in the 70s.
Well, that turned out to be a wonderful win for England, but a tremendous fight back by New Zealand, and one of which they could be very, very proud. Let's have a look now, 3 years after your debut, and you played against India, same ground, Basin Reserve, Wellington, and best figures?
It was at the time. In fact, it was a turning point in my career because I hadn't really had any successes at all. And a couple of things happened. Firstly, I should never have played because Frank Cameron, who was chairman of the selectors at that time, did something quite revolutionary in our cricket, and that is to leave a spinner out. And Hedley Howarth was thought to have played, but they left him out and they played me, along with Richard Collins, Lance Cairns, my brother Dow. So we went in there with four seamers, and sure, the pitch had a bit of greenery about it, so it was going to assist the quicker bowlers. And I didn't even open the bowling. I was demoted to number four in the bowling attack, and I hadn't played first-class cricket with a great deal of confidence. In fact, I hadn't got many wickets at all, and so I was sheltered. I was held back. And soon as I was brought to the bowling crease, three wickets happened very, very quickly, and it helped me and made all the difference. So I picked up four wickets in the first innings, and then quite dramatically in the second innings, picked up a career best with 7 for 23, which gave me my first bag of 10 or 11 in a test match.
Did you have that Antarctic breeze as you back there?
Well, of course, at Wellington, it's well known for its wind. And with the way the old ground and the old pitch was, either you had it right up your backside, or conversely, you came straight into it. And I bowled with the wind, and I bowled with quite a lot of pace, quite a lot of fire. And for the first time, I started to fulfil the potential that the selectors had actually put in me. And to get that reward set up quite a dramatic victory. And we bowled India out for 81. And that was my first success against the Indian.
Then against England, you turned in a magnificent performance in the 77-78 season. It was a fantastic match because it was the first time New Zealand had beaten England in 48 matches, and that went way back to 1929-30, and it was your bag of 10.
a very historical match for New Zealand cricket and for me personally. In fact, Geoffrey Boycott captained England at that time. Unfortunately for Mike Brearley, he broke a hand, I think it was, in Australia. So Boycott had the honour of leading England, which I guess he's always wanted to do. And I think he was the first losing, certainly the first losing English captain against New Zealand. But quite a historical match in the sense that England only had to get 130-odd to win that particular match. And because we'd blown out badly in our second innings, and I remember lying there after batting and not getting too many runs, rather frustrated and disappointing, that I thought that the game was over. And as we walked down the steps onto the field, the crowd were booing us, they were jeering us, they said, "Oh, you've wasted an opportunity." New Zealand crowds, would you believe? And there we have it. They didn't give us a lot of support. And Richard Collins and myself bowled flat out for 2 hours, that last 2 hour session. And we reduced England to something like 54 for 8 at stumps. And next morning we mopped it up pretty quickly, even though there's a little bit of rain that may have deprived us. But we got going again and bowled them out, I think, for 64.
Let's have a look at it again. Hadlee bowling the ball up outside the off stump, and Root not getting his feet into position, playing away, way from the body, getting the outside edge, and Warren Lee's taking a very fine catch behind the stumps in his right hand. And he's looked at that one, he's going to be out.
Old nine facing Richard Hadlee with England. Six down for 53.
Confident appeal, and he's gone! Yet another wicket for New Zealand.
Hadlee to Hendrick.
What a fine, that's the one they wanted. Phil Edmonds, Richard Hadlee pitching that ball up, and Edmonds hanging the bat, the ball, a simple catch to John Parker at first slip.
Well, it's not too pleased about all this, that he's being assaulted. Well, sauce for the goose. Again a stab, he's gone, that's the wicket that's wanted. Taken by... The stumps are going right, left and centre.
Well, that was the last test played at the Basin Reserve for quite some time. They did their redevelopment things then. But you had a tour of England and three test matches almost immediately after that great victory on that ground. And I expect hopes were very high.
Very much so, because we'd never performed here in England. And of course, at that time, we had a number of professional players. We had Jeff Howarth playing at Surrey, of course. I'd just started my professional career with Nottinghamshire and had played there for 6 weeks, in which the team had done particularly well, and so I was in some sort of form. And John Wright, of course, was playing at Derby. So we had a side that we felt was competitive enough to do well. But as the series went on, we lost all three rather badly. And it was a time when we had uncovered pitches too, when the weather sort of deteriorated and rains came down. If we had bowled a ball during the day and left the field, and the pitch remained uncovered. And we got caught at Trent Bridge in the second test like that, unfortunately. And Botham and Willis really, throughout the series, dominated and made life difficult for us. And really, we didn't compete in that series, and it was very, very disappointing.
And gets a very good ball, and he's out, caught behind, and Bob Taylor hung around there for a while, but up went Constance Finger, and Hadlee has taken his first wicket. And he's given him out this time, he's offered no shot, and what a deplorable end there to an innings.
And it's to be Bradley to face Richard Hadlee. That is out. No question about that. I think Richard Hadlee deserved that. He's had three chances missed. It should be out. Richard Hadlee's getting under it to make sure. Not trusting it to anyone else. the hook shot brought about Foycott's dismissal.
Bowling change at the far end. Sees Richard Hadlee coming back into the attack.
And that's edged, and he's caught this time. So at long last, the catch has been snapped up at slip. Howarth takes the wicket. And Miller goes for four. So at long last, he gets, once again, his just desserts. Admirable spell of pace bowling by Hadlee. Finally a count in there for Bob Taylor.
So Hadlee again to Gooch. Two runs coming from the first ball of this innings. Short of a length, turn on the corner. Beautifully taken there by Stephen Barker. And a great start for New Zealand with Hadlee picking up the wicket of Graham Gooch with only two runs on the board. Gooch caught, bowled Hadlee and out for two. And that's a simple catch and Radley has gone. Dug one in, didn't like it. And a very simple catch into Galley. So Richard Hadlee breaks through for New Zealand here this morning in just his second over, disposing of Clive Radley for 77.
And the shout is there and he's gone for 33. Richard Hadlee deserved that. 249 for five.
And up goes the umpire's finger, and Bob Taylor's given LBW in the bowling of Richard Hadlee. Looked slightly disappointed there. But New Zealand really on the rampage now. 258 for seven, and Taylor goes for one, LBW to Hadlee. That short, it's skite to the keeper. He's not going to miss that, I don't think. And it's another catch for Edgar. So Edmonds falling for the bouncer. It's five wickets now for Richard Hadlee. And this is a really excellent performance.
That's the prize wicket for Richard Hadlee. And Geoffrey Boycott has gone for four. Bold Hadlee, England 14 for one. Richard Hadlee will be G'd up with that success. New Zealanders will be on their toes. What a great performance. He's on a hat trick. And suddenly the game comes alive.
That was Richard's last wicket in the series, England winning the match by seven wickets and the series 3-0. Well, that's England, and you had to put that behind you fairly quickly. You then had Pakistan coming out to New Zealand, and they had some outstanding players in their side, but you still managed to do pretty well from the personal point of view.
Yes, it was an interesting series because that was the start of the Packer era in 78-79. And the first test match that we played at Christchurch, the Packer players, the Pakistani Packer players were over in Australia. So the time was right if we were to beat Pakistan to nail them at Christchurch. Unfortunately, it didn't quite work out for us because the raging Raja and Mushtaq bowled us out in the second inning, so we lost that match disappointingly. And then the Packer players came back for the second test at Napier, and of course Napier is a new test venue. In fact, I think it was the 50th test venue in world cricket, and we had a boring draw in that particular match. And I remember the Napier match for achieving my 100th test wicket when Imran Khan was caught by Warren Lee, so it was significant from that point of view. And then we had another boring draw at Eden Park, but we went down losing the series there.
What about any individual hero or player you used to look at and model yourself on?
Well, yes, one. An Australian, Dennis Lilly. I've got a great deal of admiration for him. And I watched miles and miles of video film. In fact, in my library at home, I have something like 400 videos of all sorts of movies, and obviously a lot of cricket and sporting movies in general. But I watched Dennis, and I watched his technique, I watched his action, I watched how he got people out, and at times tried to put myself into his mode of thinking. And one thing about Dennis was that he showed a lot of guts, a lot of determination, a great athlete, a lot of skill, and to come back from a very severe injury, he showed a lot of courage. And when you look at his aggression and his determination, his technical ability with the ball, where he swung it away, seamed it back, bowled the leg cutter, He intimidated the batsman and he got you out. And to me, had the hallmarks of what bowling was all about. And I often comforted myself, particularly when I was finding things a little bit difficult, when the ball was old and the pitch was flat and the batsman had 100 and things were going against you. You'd say to yourself, what would Lilly do in this situation? And quite clearly, he would never give up. He'd still compete and he'd still make life difficult for the batsman. And all of a sudden, the batsman has a go at you and he miscues one, he gets caught at cover, so he's out. A new batsman comes in, got to be vulnerable, doesn't he? First ball hit on the pad, so he might have none for 90 and all of a sudden two for 91, and five for 120 might be a good performance in the context of the match. So that thought often went through my mind when conditions were tough, that Lilly would keep going and I had to do something similar to survive.
Now, the West Indies came out to New Zealand and played a series in 1979-80, and it possibly could be said it wasn't a series played in the best of temper, but certainly it was a memorable one for New Zealand because you beat them.
We did. In fact, I've called it the sour summer because the West Indians had performed remarkably well in Australia. I think they'd won the Test Series there, probably their first ever Test Series win, I think, in Australian soil, and they won the one-day series. So they came to New Zealand with a great deal of confidence and probably didn't really want to come to New Zealand after being successful in Australia. And they probably thought that would be easy pickings anyway. And the tour really started with a one-day match at Christchurch, and we only had to get 206 to win that particular match. And we were in trouble at 80 for 5, and some of the crowd started to walk out of the ground, thinking it was all over. Then all of a sudden, Warren Lees turned the game round a bit. I got 40-odd reasonably quickly, and the West Indian fielding and bowling deteriorated. They were misfielding, their returns to the keeper were poor, and they were applauding themselves, doing all sorts of things, and the game changed and we won it. We won that one-day international, and that gave us a tremendous amount of confidence when we went down to Dunedin to play the first Test match, and really we performed remarkably well there. And we won the match only by one wicket. We only needed 104 to win, and we scraped in, having lost 9 wickets.
Here we go with Hadlee. Oh, he's gone. He's got under it, and Cairns is running back, and he's caught it. What a sensational opening. Richard Hadlee into Lawrence Rowe. Hits him on the pad. There's a loud shout, and he's out. He's given out LBW by umpire Fred Goodall. Arm raised high.
Hadlee to Kalacharan.
Well, it had to happen.
Partnership now with 66. A good shout for LBW, and he's given him out. Fred Goodall. Finger raised. Clive Lloyd got across too far then. And Richard Hadlee taking another wicket. Two holding. Oh, it's gone through, and there's an LBW field, and he's out. He's moved after it's hit him, but it looked a good shot from here.
Hadlee to Greenwich.
That looks good. Oh, good blow. Good blow. Greenwich, LBW to Hadlee for 3. The West Indies are 4 for 1.
Hadlee to Rowe.
He's out. He's got him. Rowe, LBW to Hadlee for 12. The West Indies are 21 for the loss of 2 wickets for Richard Hadlee, his 6th LBW in the match, all from that end.
Oh, this is kept low, and it's very low indeed. He's given him out, LBW.
Hadlee to Parry.
Short, it's up in the air. Wait for this. He's got it. Caught and bowled. There's the test record for Richard Hadlee. 117 wickets in test cricket.
He's just gone past Richard Collins, who's on 116.
188 for 7, Hadlee to Garner.
Bowling! What an amazing cricketer Richard Hadlee is.
The problem the West Indians found was in Australia, where the ball bounces a bit more, they had a different sort of technique. They probably played more off the back foot. so they could hit the ball. Whereas in New Zealand, if they played off the back foot with the ball keeping low and seaming a bit, they suffered for LBWs. And I picked up 11 wickets in the first test there, and there were 7 LBWs, which I think was a world record. But that's just the way it was at the time. Technically, they were inefficient in that particular test match. But the whole series was a bitter one. There was all sorts of controversy and incident. They were kicking out of the stumps. Michael Holding, unfortunately, had a good swipe at the stumps. And Colin Croft barged the umpire, of course, Fred Goodall, in the second test match. They criticised the umpiring for general decisions. And in fairness to the West Indians, decisions, I think, did go against them without question. But as professional cricketers and professional sports people, you have an obligation to the game of cricket, and really they showed quite a lot of dissent, which was a little bit disappointing. But we won the series, we won it 1-0, and that was great for New Zealand cricket because we'd competed with and against the best, and that was the turning point as far as our new era in New Zealand and world cricket was concerned, because we'd beaten the world champions, the confidence was there, and we knew that anywhere and everywhere we went, we were going to be a respected nation, and really it was the start of our credibility and respect. I picked up a few runs as well, got my first 100 in Test cricket in the second Test match there, but it was very much a hollow 100. Whilst it goes in the record books as looking impressive, it turned out to be a very easy 100.
That's 999 runs in Test cricket for Richard Hadlee.
Roberts to Hadlee, short.
A wee push away, 3 points, that's going to be 4 runs. Finally hits. Richard Hadlee is 91, his highest Test score. He has now made 1,003 runs in Test cricket. Richard Hadlee becomes the first New Zealander to achieve the double of 1,000 runs and 100 wickets in Tests. This is his 27th game for New Zealand in Test matches.
Roberts to Hadlee.
Short, pulled away off his face. That's a 6 into the number 4 stand. Richard Hadlee is 98. New Zealand are 441 for 8 wickets.
Kalacharan to Hadlee.
Short, there it is. 4 runs to the backward point boundary. Richard Hadlee, 103. New Zealand, 446 for 8 wickets. Richard Hadlee, born and bred in Christchurch, receiving the good wishes of his hometown crowd. Hadlee, 103, his first Test century. New Zealand, 446 for 8 wickets.
And then I gave it away with Kalacharan bowling at the time with the reverse sweep and got bowled.
Well, that was a great win against the West Indies. Always nice to knock off the world champions. But you had another appointment now. You'd been across to England in 1978, and you were no great shakes over there at that stage. Now, in 1983, you've got 4 Test matches and the chance of glory. But it didn't quite turn out like that.
No, it didn't. We lost the series 3-1. We lost the first match at the Oval, rather badly, actually. It was very disappointing.
Well, despite losing, you took 8 wickets with 6 for 53 in the first innings.
Hadlee, a new over. Well bowled, and he's given him out LBW. That one nip back into Fowler on the first wicket, as one might expect, has fallen to Richard Hadlee.
Richard Hadlee now from the pavilion end. Well bowled, beautifully bowled. And although Gower could be counted, I suppose, a little unlucky that the ball came back from the inside edge onto his stumps, that was a great delivery. Here's Richard Hadlee. And he's done him again. Second time someone's played on. First ball to Gower today was a very good one. That one, not quite so good, but don't worry about it because it's in the scorebook. And both of them has gone. Oh, and he's gone. Caught behind. The helmet didn't touch the stumps, but it flew. The ball flew off the gloves. And that was a good ball from Richard Hadlee.
Taylor now to face Hadlee, and a very useful ball, and he's gone LBW. Bob Taylor looking very, very plumb there, David Evans, no doubt at all. 5 wickets now for him, and that's the 14th time he's done that in a Test match. And that's it, over they go, and Richard Hadlee completes another remarkably good spell.
certainly the best bowling by a New Zealander in a test match here at the Oval.
That was a sterling performance, 6 for 53, England 209 all out, but before long, Richard found himself batting with New Zealand 41 for 5.
And he's hammered it straight past him for 4. Thought the challenge might be on there for Hadlee. Wasn't, in fact, too far away for a caught bowl. That's another one over the top. And it's 4 more. Will he put a man out now? That's another good shot. Struck very firmly off the back foot. No mid-off. Gives a long chase for Graham Fowler right down to the Vauxhall end. He's given it up. Willis finally out of the slips into mid-off. And that's cracked away again off the back foot. Fowler being kept busy. This Surrey outfield, very, very fast. It's 4 more. That wasn't hit with a great deal of power, but skimmed away over the ropes.
Shot 4. Very strong on the offside, Richard Hadlee. He's a good judge of which ball to hit. Up comes the 100. 102 for 5 now. That's a fine hit. Beautiful hit for 6, straight down the ground. Magnificent timing there by Richard Hadlee. Good shot. It was aimed at about middle and leg, and Hadlee had to get around it so he could play it straight down the ground, but it was beautifully placed. Nice shot. Good timing by Hadlee, and that'll bring up his half century. And what a very good innings it's been.
Well, that's a great shot. My word, no need to run at all. First ball, cavalier treatment, over the top of extra cover for 4 runs.
Great shot. No sooner had it cracked off the bat than it was whistling away into those covers at square point. And he's caught and bowled him. Well, I don't think that can have been in the planning. I'm very happy to give credit where it's due, but what a good innings from Richard Hadlee. The 8th wicket going down at 182. With Hadlee caught and bowled, both of them after a good partnership with Warren Lees. New Zealand were all out for 196, 13 runs behind. In England's second innings of 446, there were centuries for Fowler, Tabaret and Lamb. Hadlee taking the wickets of Gower, caught Howard for 25, and Randall caught Kearney for 3. That gave him 8 in the match, but his performance was not enough to save New Zealand from defeat by 189 runs.
But then we went to Headingley and had quite a remarkable test match there. We won it. In fact, it was our first ever test win on English soil against England. And I never got a wicket in the match, which appeared to be quite extraordinary for everyone concerned. In fact, Cairns, Coney and Chatfield were the ones that picked up the wicket. So you really had to have a name that had the letter C starting at the beginning of it. But I felt that I bowled well enough to pick up at least one or two wickets there. But I got some valuable runs in the first inning, 75, and we pulled off an historic victory there. So we had the series squared at 1-1.
Oh, he's cracked that through the offside. Lovely shot from Hadlee. Over-pitched ball. Just gave himself room.
So Richard Hadlee moves on to 12, the total of 191 for four.
Beautiful square drive. Almost as though Hadlee was waiting with a slightly overpitched delivery, and that gives him his half century. Successive half centuries in the Oval Test, and here he's hit eight fours. It's his seventh 50 for New Zealand. It's not including the century he's made as well. 52 not out. One of the great all-rounders of world cricket.
He's gone for the big one, and he's middle that over the top of mid-off. Didn't quite pick it up as he would have liked, but it's racing away down there. And it's a very good piece of fielding and chasing by Lenlang. Had a marvellous day in the field here yesterday. And he's gone for another. He's middled that in the fine style. Right over the top of extra cover. That rattles away for four runs.
Richard Hadlee at long last goes.
Third test at Lord's with a nervous moment for England debutant Chris Smith, who is facing Hadlee.
And it's a dream moment for Richard Hadlee, but not for Chris Smith, who goes first ball.
And he's gone. So, early departure there of Mike Gattin, the short one, looking for that favourite hook shot, his top edge, and very safely caught this time by John Wright. Oh, that's out. No doubt, no question there. Over goes the off stump. Hadlee strikes again, his second wicket of the morning.
And he's gone. Quarter of the wicket by Ian Smith off Hadlee, and Hadlee is finishing up with a good and well-deserved return here. It's his fourth wicket of the innings. What a marvellous catch. Ian Smith's had a good match here. He came in to replace Warren Lees in the game at Headingley, and that was a superb effort. 318 for nine now. Hadlee, five wickets in a test match for the 15th time in a great career. And that's well bowled. Hadlee strikes for the first time for New Zealand, and Martin Crowe, who was struck above the eye, has had some recompense there. Been given this time, and that really was the ball produced by the ball before. The LBW appeal turned down, and Richard Hadlee let the next one rip as fast as anything he's bowled in his life, I reckon.
Well, it's a good looking shot, but he's going straight to mid on. Right. Very anxious to swallow that one. A little dolly catch in the end. Once again, Hadlee's pace a little bit too much for the late order batsman.
On to the fourth test at Trent Bridge, your adopted home ground, and already with 16 wickets in the series and 195 test wickets.
He's out. Caught at cover. Out for 83, Derek Randall. Didn't quite get it. And Richard Hadlee picks up a well-deserved wicket.
Hadlee now to Randall. Oh, well bowled. Oh, real beauty there. And that'll be a big feather in Richard Hadley's cap.
So Bob Taylor has just come in now, facing Hadlee.
Hundy's knocked his middle stump out of the ground too. Well, a fine spell this by Hadlee, disposing of Randall, and then two balls later, knocking back Bob Taylor's stumps.
Richard Hadlee probably thinking it would be nice if he could pick up the last two wickets. He's taken 198 test wickets.
And that's all over now. So Hadlee now has 20 wickets in the series. That's the most by a New Zealander ever in England. And he's gone. So great performance by Hadlee to finish off this England innings, and with it his 200th wicket in Test match cricket. Four wickets in the innings, taking him to 200 in remarkably good time.
I remember going to Trent Bridge there and picked up my 200th Test wicket there with Norman Cowans. They all count, whether at number one or number 11. And I remember Bob Willis, who was the captain at the time, made a marvellous gesture because he could easily have declared the innings closed when I was on 199 test wickets. And he did say that we won't declare, we'll give him a chance, meaning that with Norman Cowans coming to the wicket, I had a chance there of picking up the 200th wicket, which I'm sure that Bob Willis in many ways willed me to do, because I suppose he'd been in a similar situation himself when striving to achieve personal targets or to get to a certain 100, 200 or 300 wickets, and that was a lovely gesture, and a great deal of thanks to him for that, and just shows you that there are some real gentlemen in the game of cricket, or any sport for that matter. And it didn't help us with the match at all, because we did lose it badly, and I was left 92 not out in the second innings.
That's a fine shot off the back foot. Rock back, giving myself time, and timed it very sweetly indeed. That's in the air, but safely over mid-off. Well, that's the way Richard Hadlee plays his cricket, and he'd be wise, one would imagine, to carry on in this vein. Not the type of player who can push up and down the line and try and hold out.
Well, that's a good shot. Almost as though Richard Hadlee was waiting for that, saying to himself, the bounce is coming, the bounce is coming. Didn't time that, but it's going to give Bob Willis a tough time in pulling it up before the boundary. He just flailed it away down the ground.
10 runs off those last three deliveries.
And it's gone for four. And that won't worry anyone out there too much, except Ian Botham. Four runs to Richard Hadlee. No man straight down the ground. 250 comes up for New Zealand. Four more, there's no man at third man. Went past Alan Lamb at catchable height and at about 130 miles an hour. 50 to Richard Hadlee. 66 balls faced and 11 boundaries. So he's having a very good match. He's reached 200 wickets in Test match cricket in this game.
And off in typical style. Harsh treatment for Cowan's first delivery. Clattered over mid-on for four. That's four more without any bother at all. Immensely powerful, both a front foot and back foot.
Even the Battle of Britain Memorial flight recognised the achievements of Richard Hadlee. And he's locked that away behind square leg. So they'll allow him to pick up four there. Hadley's gone to 71. And that's the end. That's the end of things, with England winning by 165 runs. John Bracewell caught Taylor Bowles-Smith for 28, and Richard Hadlee remained 92 not out. Disappointment there that he didn't make a century, but it was a delightful innings and a first-class performance from one of the world's leading all-rounders.
I think that whole series for me personally was a triumph, because in the four tests, I'd proven for the first time that I had all-round consistency with the bat and the ball. And with Ian Botham being in the England side at the moment, I would have had the better of the contest between the two of us, probably for the first time in our career, whereas Both had certainly outdone me in 1978. And as we all know, the battle of the all-rounders was starting to take shape. And there's no doubt about it that when I confront Both or Emmy or Capel, the old adrenaline flows just a little bit more, and that little private duel and contest gets going. And there's just that will and desire to do a little bit better with the bat and ball and actually get them out or score runs. And really, that was quite significant. And man of the series was important to me, and it gave me, again, the confidence to keep going on and wanting to perform.
With 21 wickets and 301 runs, who else could Jim Laker nominate as man of the series? You can see from the commentary box that there's a little bit of extra edge to the battles when those four great all-rounders take part. They were the four I was talking about a little earlier. There's one point I'd just like to make with you. It does seem a long time ago when you were seeking that 200th wicket.
It is a long time ago now. And
it's 20 wickets ago.
Well, something extraordinary happened in 1980, because I was with Notts at the time, and I found that playing 12 months of the year was taking too much of a toll on the body, and I found that I couldn't run in from 20, 25 yards day in, day out and compete. And so I had to make a dramatic change to my technique, and change was probably the greatest change in my bowling, was to come off the longer run-up and bowl off the shorter one. And it was just failed to be accepted back home in New Zealand.
Did they think you were bludging?
They thought that I was taking shortcuts. And the thought was that how could Richard Hadlee, the strike power of New Zealand cricket, be effective off a short runner? It was as though that I wasn't giving 100%. And unfortunately, the pressure on my body at the time was just too much, and I had a lot of ankle ligament problems, so I had no alternative but to economise. It wasn't accepted by the media in particular. The spectators gave me a hard time. Some of the players refused to accept it. So my total professionalism was questioned. And it wasn't until a year or two later when I started to have some good successes off the shorter run-up and proved that I could still do the job. In fact, quite frankly, it fine-tuned me as a bowler. It made me a far better bowler, more of a complete bowler, because I had better control. Because I'd lost a yard of pace, I had to do things a bit better, so I was able to swing and seam the ball, cut the ball. I could still bowl the odd bouncer and intimidate the batsman, still get him out. And I found that I could bowl in longer spells. So the all-round effectiveness of the shorter runner proved to be exactly the right thing to do. But unfortunately, in the early stages, I was alternating between the long and short, and it just didn't work because there was different rhythms and timings, different training involved. And so I had to make a clear-cut decision in 1982, as I did, that it was the short run for the rest of my career. Otherwise, I would have been out of the game 5 or 6 years ago. And it's just kept me going. It's given me a longer life in the game. And it was significant, that particular change, and thankfully some very good rewards came about.
And at what stage might we loosely say that was accepted in New Zealand by the people who wouldn't accept it originally?
I would have thought it would have taken a couple of years from the decision that I had made. And it was just amazing. I was very depressed, very disappointed about it, and had tears in my eyes at times because I was just reading things in the paper, just getting negative feedback generally from people. I found it very difficult to cope with, but the only answer at the end of the day was to get out there and perform and get wickets. And of course the wicket tally kept getting bigger and bigger, and of course the success rate also here, playing for Nottinghamshire at the time, when I got 100 wickets the following year, and did it twice. And I got 97 in my last year in 1987, so the wicket tally was improving all the time. The strike rates were even far better, and it wasn't costing me as many runs per wicket. And so everything about it was quite beautiful, and I can turn around and say that to all those knockers that, you know, I was disappointed at the time, but it's nice to prove them wrong.
Well, just to recap on that series, at the Oval, 6 for 53, 2 for 99 and 84. The second test at Leeds, where New Zealand scored their famous victory, 75. Third test at Lords, 5 for 93, 3 for 42 and a great catch. Fourth test at Trent Bridge, 4 for 85, 200th test match wicket and 92, which is as good a way of introducing, as I know, Richard, the next series against England in New Zealand, where you absolutely slaughtered them in the middle test match of a series of three where two others were drawn.
Yes, well, the first test at Wellington was a match really that England should have won, but we battled out of it with the captain Jeremy Coney doing well. But when we came to Lancaster Park, Christchurch, quite an extraordinary test match because we batted first on a pitch that was a little bit frisky. But England didn't bowl particularly well. Tony Pigott came into the side, that Ian Botham, of course, and Bob Willis. Both didn't bowl that well. And even though we lost a few sort of early wickets, we managed to get out of it. And I managed to cream my way to 99 with a little bit of width that the bowlers gave me. They bowled a little bit short and a bit wide and a bit full and allowed me to play the way that I like to play, and that is to attack and hit the ball. And I just flayed it everywhere and kept chasing it and chasing it and hit some beautiful shots.
A wide one. He gets hold of it reasonably well. It may not go for four. Getting after it, but he can't pull it in. Short one, Hadlee pulling. It's in front of square. Going out to the number three stand for four runs. Cramped, rather cramped with the shot, but still getting four for it, so Hadlee racing forward now onto 59. He's flicked this one over the top, though. That's four runs to Hadlee. Pigott trying to tighten his line up to Hadlee, but drifting down the leg side, he clips it just in front of square, and so he goes on to 70.
Bold shot by Richard Hadlee, and he found the gap, which wasn't very wide, between long off and a deepish extra cover, and Richard Hadlee has powered his way to 88. New Zealand at 270 for six.
Hadlee 12 runs short of what would be his second test century, facing Tony Pigott. And again, he's hit it in the air, and he's again found a gap which wasn't very wide, this time down behind square on the leg side, and Richard Hadlee moves into the 90s, and I suspect for him they're not too nervous 90s today. He's 92, and New Zealand is 274. Oh, a glorious shot from Richard Hadlee. Richard Hadlee is 96. New Zealand at 278 for six wickets. An appeal for a catch behind, and Richard Hadlee is out. Oh, what tragedy for Hadlee.
But I nicked one to Bobby Taylor off Bob Willis on 99, and many people will say that you'd have to be disappointed with that, and sure, I was disappointed I didn't get to 100, but nor did England in either innings.
That's absolutely right. I suppose you could be well satisfied with the 99 you got and 8 for 44.
Yes, we bowled as we normally do in our conditions, just normal line length, consistent, containing sort of bowling. And that's really been the hallmark of New Zealand successes and bowling over a long period of time, where we haven't had real genuine pace strike bowlers. We've had good bowlers that like Ewan Chatfield and Lance Cairns that just come in and bowl tight and give very little away. And we've got to bowl a lot of overs to get wickets. But on this particular condition where, as I say, the bounce was a little bit uneven and we've got the ball to swing a bit and deviate a bit, the English batsman was English batting was a little bit inadequate.
He came in with a spell of 3 for 2 in England's first innings, and they were all out for 82. Now in their second innings, Taveray faces Hadlee.
And that's an appeal for a catch behind, and Taveray is out.
Hadlee to Gar.
And he's out. Is out for eight. England are 23 for two in their second innings.
Hadlee, the start.
In the air.
It's in the air.
And the rebound, he does. Lance Cairns. A third slip. Short and wide. And Randall going for the cuts. Gets a top edge. Cairns parries it up in the air and is able to catch it on the rebound, and so Randall is out for 25, and the eighth England wicket is down for 76. And Willis edges, and it goes into the first gully position. Howarth taking the catch, and so Willis is out, and Hadlee takes his fourth wicket. Willis not opening his account. Hadlee, and he's edged it behind, and he's out, caught behind. Hadlee takes five. New Zealand win this test match by an innings and 132 runs.
And they blamed and criticised the pitch for being poor. Sure, it wasn't perhaps up to test standard, but it wasn't as bad as they made out. But we won that match convincingly. In fact, we won it, I think, in 12 hours, 1 minute of play, which was quite extraordinary because we lost a couple of days through rain. And so that, I think, probably one of the quickest test match results almost in the history of the game. And then we went to Auckland for the last test match there, and that was a boring affair because both teams got 400 and that was it. But a series win for New Zealand at home was our first ever.
Do you recall that when you bowled them out for 82 and you had them 33 for 6 in the second innings, that you were actually going for the situation of bowling them out below 100 in both innings?
I'm sure we were aware of it, but they got out of it just a little bit. But really their performance at the time was inadequate, and the fact that we scored over 300, they were played out of the game, and I suppose at the end of the day they were quite happy to to get the game over, because they just were not competitive in any aspect of the game. And really it was almost a complete performance by the New Zealand side, where we got runs on the board, we caught well, and we bowled consistently well and got the result that we thoroughly deserved.
Then you created just a little niche in New Zealand cricket history by going off to Colombo to play a test match against Sri Lanka.
Yes, and of course playing in that part of the world is never easy because it's very hot, humid and sticky. And it was the first time that I'd been to that country. And, playing in foreign conditions is never easy. And it's always an advantage to the home side, of course. And so we're always going to struggle to acclimatise to the type of conditions. But we had an amazing test match win in the first match at Kandy, at the Askiria ground. And then we had a draw, I think, in the second match at Colombo. And then we played another test match at another cricket ground in Colombo. And we won that one quite convincingly. Again, it was a very good performance. Again, I picked up wickets. I think I got naught. When I batted, but we won that match and clinched the series 2-0, and that was a positive result for us because we don't have many test series or test result wins overseas, and we're again starting to perform in foreign conditions, and it was a good haul for me. I think I picked up 22 wickets in the series at about 12 apiece.
And got 10 in that match,
yes.
And New Zealand won by an innings in 61. So let's turn now to Australia in 1985-86. It's the first test match in Brisbane, and was it New Zealand's perfect test?
Without question. Of all the tests that I'd played in, this had to be the fairy tale one. It couldn't have been written better. We won the toss at the Gabba and decided to bowl first, where conditions were overcast and cloudy and a bit humid. The pitch was reasonably frisky in the first morning. And we're on and off the field, funnily enough, through weather, which meant that I could bowl for most of the day. And we bowled Australia out relatively cheaply.
Here now, the first of those wickets, Andrew Hilditch.
There's the hook shot, it's in the air. And Ewan Chatfield has taken the catch. A brilliant catch at fine leg. He's not noted for his fielding.
And the next victim was David Boone.
Catch!
He's gone, that's beautifully taken. He has got good hands.
Borders hit, he's out, first ball after lunch, he's driven on the up to cover. Wasn't a good shot, but it was a good safe catch, and what a breakthrough from Richard Hadlee. He's gone, yes, beautiful piece of bowling. This is one of the great spells of test bowling by Richard Hadlee. The number one striker picks up Greg Ritchie, and Australia are reeling at 4 for 82.
Oh, and that's got to be very close. I would say that's out, yes. Not much doubt about that. A very good delivery from Richard Hadlee, moving back into the left-hander. And Kepler Vessels, I think, even if he had been playing a shot, still would have been out. He was well and truly in line. Oh, and right through him. Clean bowled.
on that occasion playing a shot, but it wasn't down the right line, and Hadlee has made it 6 out of 6. Oh, and he's gone through Phillips as well.
It's gone. Great catch. Best figures ever for Richard Hadlee, 8 for 52. His previous best was 7 for 23 against India in 1975-76.
Bob Holland survived just 3 balls before falling to Hadlee.
He's gone, yes, 9 wickets. What a wonderful performance from Richard Hadlee. One of the all-time great performances at the Gabba. His teammates rushed to congratulate the great fast bowler, and what a privilege it has been to watch that performance.
And for me personally, to pick up 9 wickets in an innings for 52 runs is my greatest ever bowling performance in a test match, because you dream about the ultimate and it very rarely happens, but to get 9 was quite incredible. And I caught the other batsman
out. 10 at one stage.
Well, it was probably on, because I had the first 8 and then Vaughan Brown bowled, and I took the catch when Geoffrey Lawson hit out. And some people have often said to me, why didn't you drop it? And I said, well, the game of cricket's not like that. You take every chance that you can. And it was significant for Vaughan Brown, of course, because that was his first ever test wicket. But we bowled them out cheaply, and then we batted quite splendidly. And with Martin Crowe getting 188, I think it was, and John Reid getting 100, we managed to get a very big lead and put a lot of pressure on the Australians.
The bouncer, it's in the air, Chatfield under it, and he's gone again to the hook shot. And Hilditch hangs his head in shame as Richard Hadlee enjoys the moment.
Wayne Phillips also fell to the conquering Richard Hadlee.
Oh, he's got him. Oh, once again, Phillips has dragged the ball back onto his stumps. He did that in the first innings, and there he was on the back foot, trying to force Hadlee away on the offside. Got an inside edge, and it's back onto his off stump.
Edged and gone. Jeremy Coney, the second slip specialist, has ended a magnificent partnership, just 3 runs short of the 200. And a simple catch on this occasion. Craig McDermott just spooning it back to Hadlee. And out. Caught at extra cover. Safely caught there. And he's got him right through him, and that makes it 6 in the second innings, 15 for the match, and New Zealand have won by an innings and 41 runs.
15 wickets for me in the match, which was my best ever return, again a New Zealand record, 50-odd runs with the bat. It was my perfect performance and the team's perfect performance and our first ever win against Australia on Australian soil. And it was significant in our history because it set up our first ever series win that we were to have in Australia.
And on what seemed from the commentary box anyway, a pretty good batting track.
Yes, well, as the game went on, normally conditions get better and better, I think. And, you know, the Aussies, I don't think, batted particularly well against us. Glenn Turner made a dramatic change to my bowling, whereby we used a rubbish bin, funnily enough, as a position for the umpire to stand at practice, because he felt that I was bowling a little bit too wide of the crease, and he said, I've got to get you a bit closer. And so we actually worked out where the umpire should stand, and I mark him to this very day 6 feet behind the wickets, so that I can get in closer, because if you've got an umpire standing up too close to the wickets, he tends to push you a bit wide of the crease. So we got him absolutely right, so I could get in close. I bowled wicket to wicket, got the ball to swing and seam away, and always felt that if the Australian batsman had weaknesses, it was on or about off stump with the ball moving away particularly, because they tend to play on the back foot, they tend to square up and hover around the crease a bit, and if you get the ball to deviate a bit, you had a chance for the slip catching, and of course we took some very, very good slip catches right throughout the series. And it was my best ever series, 33 wickets in a 3-match series at a very, very high strike rate at a very low cost of about 12, 13 runs per wicket. And it was significant that that performance was to win our first ever series on Australian soil.
This is not meant to be a coaching tape or a coaching video, but is that where it all began, the real bowling wicket to wicket, where you went into the nets and you had this garbage bin there to simulate the umpire? And you worked on it in that way, because that's one of the best pieces of advice I've ever heard for young bowlers.
Yes, because even though I was bowling off the shorter run-up, I was still bowling about midway between the crease and sometimes a bit wider, because I got psychologically just pushed wider without even really thinking about it. But once I got in a lot closer, I was able to still control the ball, but still bowl wicket to wicket. So it gave me a greater chance for LBWs, which meant that the batsmen, they had to play at you. Even if the ball was nipping away, they still had to play at you if it was straight enough, because they didn't know if it was going to nip back, you see. And if it did, you had a chance of an LB or bowled. And so that really, at that performance, that 9 for 52 in that test match at the Gabba, was a complete bowling performance. And I remember Max Walker actually making a comment at the end of the day that it was pure skill. No intimidation, no bounces, just skill, where the ball virtually talked. It swung and it seamed and it bounced. And for the first time, I'd bowl consistently well to both left and right-hand batsmen, because I have had problems bowling to the left-hander because I naturally drift it too straight or down the leg side. But I got it right to these fellas. And got wickets, which was tremendous, and was a very good team performance at the end of the day, even though I may have been the catalyst for setting it up.
And it brought 9 for 52 and 6 for 71 in that game, but the Australians won the second match of the series, and then in Perth in the third, it was 5 for 65 and 6 for 90, and it was a win for New Zealand and a win in the series as well.
We should never have played the test match at Perth there, because it had just been revamped. And the outfield was like sponge, and it was very difficult to run on it. You just sort of sunk too far down in it. There were very few boundaries hit in it, and the pitch was too new as well. And I found it probably the most difficult bowling performance I've ever done, because the footholes just gouged out. And I remember actually seeing the cricket ball placed in one of the holes, and it just went right across. That's how deep it was, and it was just so dangerous. And I didn't bowl very well in the first innings at all. Switched ends for the second innings and bowled a lot better. And we bowled Australia out, which was a pretty good performance, and got the runs required to win that particular match and win the Trans-Tasman Cup for the first time. And again, another historical moment in New Zealand cricket that we could win a test series away from home.
David Boone takes strike to Richard Hadlee.
Both of them would be looking for one.
And there's Saw. Has he caught it? Yes, he has. Gone up the go, and he's gone. What a breakthrough for the New Zealanders. Alan Border out caught behind off the bowling of Richard Hadlee.
Edged and taken by Jeff Crowe at first slip. So Richard Hadlee picks up number 291.
Now Hadlee again.
He's bowled him. Dragged the ball back off the inside edge onto the leg stump. Matthews perhaps getting a little bit over bowled there.
Trying to crunch that one through the offside, I reckon.
Hadlee to Holland. That's it. End of the innings. Australia got past the 200 mark. 9 for 203. Now all out for 203. Barton Crowe takes the catch, and Hadlee takes another 5 wickets.
Richard Hadlee coming in now to bowl to Rob Kerr.
Oh, and he's bowled him right through Robbie Kerr. He hasn't been on the field at all. Injured finger.
Hadlee comes in now to Boone.
And he's got him. Chopped it on. Hadlee coming around the wicket. That one stayed down a little bit.
He's just over pitching at the moment.
Oh, and he's gone right through his defence. Border again looking to get on with the job against Hadlee. And Hadlee has got right through him. I think there may have been a little inside edge.
Hadlee to Matthews.
Oh, that's very close. Yes, Greg Matthews on his way, right back in front of the stumps. And Peter McConnell didn't have to think too long and hard about that one. Edged and taken by Jeff Crowe at first slip. So Richard Hadlee is still on target for that 300. He now needs to get 2 out of 2. That gives him 298.
Hadlee comes in now to Gilbert.
On right through him, so he's still on target, and on target for the 300. That makes 299.
Bracewell took the last wicket in that match, so there was an enforced wait of 11 weeks to join the 300 club. The Australians were again on the receiving end. The first test match was in Wellington.
Ball again for LBW. There it is. 300 test wickets for Richard Hadlee.
Now you're the sixth member of the select 300 club in only your 61st test match. And astonishingly, the last 100 have come in just 17 tests. And this 300th victim appropriately was witnessed by your fellow Kiwis. After two draws, New Zealand won by 8 wickets in Auckland to take the series 1-0. Then across to England, the first test match was at Lord's.
Oh, that's out. Gooch is gone and Hadlee gets his reward.
Oh, and beautifully bowled. What a ball to get. First ball after lunch from Hadlee. Magnificent piece of bowling. Jeff Crowe, the catcher. He's out this time. The only thing umpire Whitehead would have had to decide there would be if the ball was low enough to hit the bails. Beautifully bowled by Richard Hadlee. No doubt about that. Four to Hadlee. The bail has gone way, way, way down the field. The England captain goes back.
No. There's one gone. 5 wickets for Hadlee once again, 26 times.
That's it, Graham Daly's out, and the bails are off. Umpire Whitehead takes off the bails. It's a 6th wicket to Richard Hadlee. Well caught by Ian Smith. That's a tremendous effort by Richard Hadlee.
And then in the second test match, 6 for 80, 4 for 60, 68, man of the match, and another New Zealand win.
Yes, we drew the first test match at Lord's, then went to Trent Bridge, which had significant importance for me because I was reappearing at my home ground, of course, having played a number of years at Trent Bridge for Nottingham. And yes, we won that particular match, which was a great win for New Zealand cricket. Again, another almost complete performance by the New Zealand side. And then we drew the last test at the Oval there to win the series. And that was our first ever series win against England on English soil.
And that's got to be out. The goose didn't even turn. Beautifully bowled by Hadlee.
Beautifully bowled. Oops, he's bowled him. And that got through. It was very well up to Mike Gadding. And that wicket, the third wicket for Richard Hadlee, brings him now level with Bob Willis in the Test aggregate. 325 wickets, and it's a highly prized victim. Mike Gatting, the England captain, bowled by Hadlee for 17.
Oh, well bowled. Beautifully bowled. And Richard Hadlee goes ahead of Bob Willis now. Oh, well bowled again. 2 in 3 balls. The softener. And then the beautiful away swinger. What a very fine bowler. Very comprehensive indeed, but young Thomas played extremely well.
How did you motivate yourself for that match? Back at Trent Bridge, wanting to beat England, how did you do it?
Well, the thing is that they were, in fact, my home crowd. And I think deep down they wanted me to personally do well, but of course English cricket to do well. And there are a lot of good friends and great memories there at Trent Bridge. And as you walk into the ground, people say, all the best, good luck sort of thing. And that's a bit of a stimulus, because you know you've got the people supporting you in general. And I bowled, I think, consistently well in that match and got some runs. And it was a good fighting effort by the lads in general. And I just felt comfortable in that environment because it didn't feel strange to me. It was just like playing at Lancaster Park at home in Christchurch. And it was important and significant to do well in front of those people that had been with you for such a long time.
Okay.
That's a classical four. And the 150 comes up. David strokes, a square cut, forcing stroke off the back foot, and the straight drive off the quick bowlers, and Greg Thomas is coming back. Hadlee can't stop that one. Don't give Hadlee any room outside that off stump. It's evaded Athey, there's no one covering. There's full toss. Richard Hadlee reaches his half century. Innings without chance, but it's been a responsible innings because his side were faltering. He came in to score 144 for five, and now it's 207 for five.
Just out of Bruce French's reach, but far enough. Gatting has come out of the slips. He has a very square gully. Two men on the offside saving the single or the four. And there it is, providing you're straight enough. Lovely shot. Beautifully timed and placed.
It and Greg Thomas gets Richard Hadlee. It's Graham Gooch, the man who dropped the catch earlier on, who this time safely pouches it. And so this fine innings has come to an end. Richard Hadlee caught Gooch, bowled Thomas, 68. It's 239 to 6.
And you're really into, or the spectators and cricket followers are really into, the battle between the all-rounders now, because everyone, I won't say everyone was at their peak, but everyone was playing pretty well out of that little quartet.
There was a lot of competition, and as I say right at the start, I mean, the adrenaline flows a little bit more when you pit your skill against another all-rounder. In fact, I've always said to the lads, particularly in the 80s, that one way to motivate yourself is to pick an opponent in the opposition. Now, it might be John Wright picking Graham Gooch as his partner, and you've got to outdo them, you've got to beat them. The wicketkeeper against wicketkeeper, fast bowler against fast bowler, spinner against spinner, all-rounder against all-rounder. And if you actually beat them in that particular match as far as runs or wickets or catches taken, or do the same in the series, and you've got six or seven of your blokes doing that, you're going to win. And so we have those little private duels or contests going, as I would have a go against the all-rounder. The others had to take on their man as well. And I found that that was a very significant change in our attitude. And the little contests that were going on between batsman and bowler, bat and ball, the inner games as such, outside the general concept, were very, very important as a motivating factor.
New Zealand made 413, and there was early success for Hadlee. He dismissed Moxon, caught behind by Ian Smith for 23. And here he is now, coming into bowl to night watchman Philippe Edmonds.
And LBW Edmonds, going right across to Richard Hadlee. Caught it. New ball goes through for New Zealand. Hadlee breaks through again. 9 wickets in the match. And a very, very brave innings by John Embury comes to an end.
Then Richard Hadlee has something to bowl for here. He's never taken 10 wickets against England. Oh, that looks out. It came back like a rocket from outside off stump. And Gladstone Small was trapped there, right in front of his wickets. Superb bowling, so Richard Hadlee takes his 10 wickets for the first time against England.
That type of motivational work's very important against all countries, but particularly against the West Indies, I would think, who are very much on top. And they did very well against you in the first test of your next series, but then you came back at them.
The first test was a very big disappointment for us because we got annihilated, smashed out of sight, and Gordon Greenidge got a big double century. And I was so fed up and so annoyed at our performance, where we lacked professionalism and dedication, that I wrote an article in the newspaper to that effect, and I got rebuked for that. And it caused a Coney-Hadlee clash for the second test match starting at Christchurch. And we were really in no frame of mind to go out there and play. The first day had been washed out with rain, and it in effect really became sort of a 3-4 day test match. And any chance of us getting a result to square the series was always going to be somewhat difficult. However, we bowled them out for 100, quite unbelievably so. And I got 6 for 50 and didn't bowl well. In fact, after 4 or 5 overs, I took myself off from the bowling crease because I hadn't bowled well. But Ewan Chatfield bowled splendidly, got 4 wickets for not too many. And normally when somebody gets 5 or 6 wickets, you actually lead the players from the field to the applause of the crowd. But I knew I hadn't done the job particularly well, and I pushed Ewan Chatfield ahead of me to receive the applause, because he was the one that was instrumental at that time for bowling the West Indies out for not too many.
Bowling! Early success for New Zealand. Richard Hadlee bowls Desmond Haynes, and the West Indies are 2 for 1. Edge. Richardson's gone. Edge. Jeremy Coney has the catch. Edge. Another one for Hadlee. 8 wickets down now for West Indies. Edge. Coney has another one. And Richard Hadlee has 5 wickets for the 29th time in his test career.
That's the end of it. Richard Hadlee gets his 6th.
We bowled them out in the second innings for 300 or so, and we only needed 33 to win the match, seemingly an easy target. But we lost 5 wickets in doing it. But we won the match, we squared the series, so retained a sort of unbeaten record as far as winning or squaring series were concerned. We had never lost a test series at home during the 80s at that time, which again was a very impressive record and performance for us.
Any time to beat the West Indies when they're on top form is a marvellous moment. But what about your 150 against Sri Lanka?
Yes, well, that tour of Sri Lanka only lasted about 11 days. We got bombed out because of a civil war going on at the time.
Not because of your 150.
No. In fact, again, that'd be one of the great disappointments of my career, in that a tour was not allowed to continue for political reasons. And as we know, politics and sport is not really a healthy situation. But that test match did continue, it did finish. A boring draw, we won the toss and decided to put Sri Lanka in, and Brendan Karupu got a double century in that match. They amassed probably 400 plus. And Jeff Crowe and myself batted together for a long time and probably added 250, 260 for whatever wicket it was. And I got 151 not out, which was my highest ever test score. And irrespective of the opposition, you've still got to do it. You've still got to get the runs. And so that's a special moment for me to again reach the 3 figures for the second time only in my test career. And to get 151 and end up not out, it was nice. But we went home literally days later after one test match and what should have been a 3 test match series.
And you did establish one record in that match, 803 runs scored, and neither keeper conceded a bye. I suspect it may have been because not very much got past the bat.
Not too much got past the bat. It was a very flat track, very low, and the batsman just pushed forward all the time, and anyone that actually beat the bat deserved a medal.
Here you also equaled Dennis Lilly's record of 355 wickets in the same number of test matches, 70. Well, let's move away from test for a while now and turn to your success with Nottinghamshire. Let me take you back now to the 1982 semi-final of the Benson Hedges, where you had to play Lancashire, and Lancashire 182 and Nottinghamshire I might pose it this way, in all sorts of trouble.
Yes, we were. it was quite an amazing turnaround, actually. A good crowd in, and we'd reached the semi-finals not too often in any one-day competition, so we've never ever made a Lord's final, so it was an important match to win for us to get to Lord's. And I remember coming to the wicket batting at the time, and I had an injured hamstring, and I certainly struggled to actually time the ball. And I remember hitting out and got dropped by Ian Foley at mid-on when I'd had sort of two or three, and I should have been out rather easily, but I survived, and all of a sudden Bernard Reedy was bowling to me, and I managed to hit a couple in the bat, sort of 12 or 13 runs came off one over, and I was away, and got to 55 reasonably quickly. And we managed to win the match, but we did have some scary moments because we had lost more than half our wickets for about just over half the runs. And so it was a very close thing, but we sneaked home, I think, in the last over. So we won the match and we got to Lord's for the first time in our cricketing history, which was always going to be a special moment.
First Croft. Croft figures of 3 for 20 after 7 overs. And slightly over 6.5 runs an over wanted. And he's hoisted it away and he's dropped him. Well, that could have been the turning point. It's the wicket that Lancashire desperately needed to see the end of Richard Hadlee. Unfortunate folly out there.
And it's now 127 for six. Here's Bernard Reedy again. And there's Richard Hadlee. Jack Simmons. Six. And suddenly the ground here at Trent Bridge becomes alive with the shouts of Nottinghamshire supporters. You can see a ray of hope where almost none existed just 5 minutes ago. Great shot. Magnificent stroke that. Hadlee goes to 27. Mullet to Hadlee. What a super shot.
The Lancashire bowlers just losing a little bit of control at the moment.
And there are two test bowlers in Croft and Allett who still have overs to go. Be a hitter, Richard Hadlee, but he is a very cool customer. He's just picking off these bowlers, placing the ball perfectly. Not frightened to hit it in the air, but the placement is superb.
And yet another magnificent shot, picked up from just outside the off stump. The natural swing.
Beautifully. That was just fractionally short. Allett to Hadlee, who's on 49. And there's his half century. And the standing ovation for Richard Hadlee on his home ground. It was in the 48th over that Richard Hadlee was only 12. Here we are now in the 53rd over and he's 51. Just 3 runs needed. And 2 overs to go. Here's Colin Croft. And there it is. What a way to finish. 55 not out, Richard Hadlee. Wonderful innings.
That was in 1982. 2 years later, you achieved something that I didn't think was going to happen again. Didn't think it was possible. We used to come on tour to England and we'd play 30 matches on the tour. People don't do that these days, and yet you did the double.
I did the double that particular year. It was planned, it was plotted, it was carefully analysed and set out, although for two previous years I'd failed to do it. Not many people probably realised. Not to the same degree, but I actually sat down. In fact, in 1981, when we won the county championship, you know, I got 100 wickets that year and 740-odd runs. And Ken Taylor said to me, what about achieving the double? And I said, well, what's that? And he said, it's 1,000 runs and 100 wickets in the season. I said, oh, yeah, right. So I tried it in 82. And injury again prevented me from seeing the season out. In 83 we had the Tour of England, so I couldn't do it that particular year. So 84 had to be the season to do it, if I was going to do it. The weather was fine, the opportunities were there. And quite simply, the calculation was to score 1,000 runs in, say, 20 matches, you've got to score 50 a game or take 5 wickets a match. And so the budget was set out. I even went to the extent of working out how many overs I would bowl in the season, where I'd was more likely to get my wickets either at home or away and against what opposition. So it was all meticulously plotted out on a piece of paper. And the wickets came quite easily. I mean, I was well on target for that. However, I was struggling in the runs and always likely to do that the way I play and batting at 7 in the order. I may not have got the opportunities. And as I say, well behind budget. And we came to Lord's to play Middlesex. And we bowled Middlesex out reasonably cheaply, and we were about 4 for 17 ourselves, with Wayne Daniel and Norman Cowans causing a few problems. And Ricey said to me, it's Clive Rice, the captain, he says, go out there and score a double 100. And I says, you what? My highest ever score at that time was probably 130, 140, you see. And blow me down, 7 hours later, I was 210 not out, which put me back on target, back on budget. The wickets eventually came at Blackpool against Lancashire, and a few days later we got to Trent Bridge on a bank holiday to play Warwickshire. 1,000 runs cropped up, so I'd achieved the double, a personal milestone.
You needed 21 when you came into that match, and is it right that someone said to you, how are you going to get them? And you said, 3 good hits and a push?
Something like that, yeah. They came very quickly. It was nice to get off the mark, and I said to Jeff Humpage, the Warwickshire wicketkeeper at the time, I'm going to get these runs quickly. And he says, well, good luck. And the runs came off Chris Old at the time. But it was relief, because it became obsessional with me. I was going home filling in my little budget at the end of the day and saying, well, this is what I've got to do tomorrow. And it's very dangerous when you strive for targets to become obsessional and get uptight and tense about it and worry about things. And I found that I was doing that, and I wasn't easy to live with. And it was pretty difficult even at the cricket grounds and the dressing rooms at times, where you're in pursuit of personal achievements. But I don't believe at any stage it upset the team pattern or anything of that nature, because irrespective of what people might say and think, I am single-minded, but I still like to think I am a team man, and whatever I've been able to achieve, then other players and teams and countries have benefited through that.
To find out how difficult you were to live with, we may have to do a video with Lady Hadlee.
Yes, well, yeah, that's right, you might have to.
In the NatWest final 1987, North Hants made 228 for 3 from 50 overs, and when Richard came out to bat, Notts were 84 for 5. The question was, could he pull it off again in his final appearance at Lord's for his adopted county? And when play resumed on the Monday, he faced Richard Williams.
That's common sense batting from Hadlee. Beautifully placed, and 2 runs. ...10.43 needed, and this is Richard Williams' last over. Lamb. And it's gone right over. Not sure it didn't get a little bit of an assist from Alan Lamb. Might just have got his fingertips to it. Bailey. Lost it. Lost it in the sun. Can't blame him for not having a cap on. He's got it on and pulled down low over his eyes. So things going a little awry for North Hants. Lamb. Well, 3 in 3 balls. Did that quite reach Alan Lamb, or did it just bounce a fraction in front of him? Yeah! It may not have come off the centre of the bat, but a little goal to Notts' dressing room.
has four overs to go and 40 needed to win. Winston Davis is being brought back in. That's good fielding, but not good throwing. Backing up was okay, but then came the fumble. So, all sorts of little accidents. Cruel for Davis. He wanted to keep the ball up in the block hole and nerves or whatever dragged it down, and Hadlee took care of it. Bruce French has strike. 8 runs needed and 6 balls remaining. You wouldn't believe it. Bounced off the other batsman into the bowler's hands, and French, the striker, is run out. And here he is bowling to Hadlee. Bailey. Oh, it's over. What a hit. What a hit from Richard Hadlee. At the most crucial moment, he has smashed it away down the ground. That's it. That's it. And Richard Hadlee, on his last appearance at Lord's, has made an unbeaten 70, and Nottinghamshire have won the NatWest Trophy final for 1987.
A great moment for Notts cricket and for me personally, to be standing there holding the NatWest Trophy along with Clive Rice and my father being present as well. And very significant that particular year in 87, because not only did we win that particular title, but we also won the championship, the county championship, in our last year. So we'd won it twice in the 80s, 3 Lord's appearances with 1 victory there, and a few runner-up places during the 80s. So really my time at Notts along with Clive Rice was a great era in the history of Notts cricket in the modern times.
It certainly was. And that's a little run through the domestic scene. A look now at 3 matches just before we come to the 1990 season in England, which was your farewell. The 3 very significant games, one against Australia, one against India, and then again against the same country. The Australians, the last test match in Melbourne, where New Zealand, well, New Zealand had you bowling the last over, and you were bowling it to Michael Whitney and Craig McDermott.
Well, we were never in the match, actually, even at tee on the last day. I think Australia needed something like 120 runs to win the match with 5 or 6 wickets in hand, and one would have thought that they would have cruised it. But somehow we got back into the match quite incredibly straight after tee, and Australia ended up defending and trying to save that particular match. And I had to bowl the last over, as you say, to Mike Whitney. And Mike Whitney, if you'd excuse me in saying that, you know, he wouldn't be one of the top number 11 batsmen in world cricket.
Give us a quick rating with Devon Malcolm.
I think I'd rather bowl to Devon because I got him out a few times, but I didn't get Mike out, and I'd bowled something like 30-odd overs in the day, and it was the big effort that was required, and I needed to get that wicket to win the match and square the series, of course, and we failed to do it. But what an enthralling test match. It was a great test match, and I was left on 373 test wickets at that time, which was equal with Ian Botham. And it was disappointing not to have won that match, but the effort went in, but the reward wasn't quite there.
That's pretty close. Yes, umpire Crafter has a good long look and says, I'm sorry, David, you're on your way. So Richard Hadlee has struck.
Oh, he's got him. My ball, Richard Hadlee. That was an incredible delivery. One almost got the feeling that Marsh was frozen to the ground. He hardly moved. The ball seemed to find its way to the bat and then scoot away and was well taken at third slip. Oh, he's got him. He's out to behind. There's no doubt about that. That is a magnificent ball too.
and he's gone. Well now, Richard Hadlee has shouted, everyone has shouted out there. Valletta is extremely disappointed.
That's a bit closer, and he's been given by umpire Tony Crafter. That one cutting back into the right-hander.
Hadlee to continue. Gone! Last day break through, and it's Hadlee. This time the catch is taken. That's the quest. He's got him! Yes, that's the one they wanted!
That's very, very close, yes. Peter Sleep really didn't even bother to hang around.
Gone! He's gone! He caught behind! The great Hadlee gets the edge! And have we got a test match? What a beautiful piece of bowling.
Oh, that's very, very close, yes. Too close for comfort if you're an Australian. And Tony Dottermaid is on the way. And just for a change, Richard Hadlee has taken 5 wickets in an innings. That's 32 times in Test cricket. And he's 13th against Australia.
And another 10-wicket haul against Australia. Then to India, 1988, in the second test at Bombay, 10 wickets in the match for the 9th time. New Zealand won by 136 runs, but it was India who provided another milestone at Christchurch in 1990. A tremendous performance there because it came at a time where you were having injury problems.
I had an Achilles tendon operation in November of 1989, and at the age of 38, when you have leg operations like that, there's not too many incentives to get over them and strive to rehabilitate yourself to come back. But the incentive for me was, of course, is on 396 test wickets, and trying to be the first man to get to 400 was like achieving a major barrier. Like Sir Edmund Hillary conquering Everest, or Roger Bannister doing the first sub-4-minute mile. The challenge was there, and that was the thing that kept me going. And I had to rehabilitate myself against the odds, because the surgeon only gave me a 70% chance of getting back on the field again.
I gave you none, because as you'll recall, I saw you at the Sportsman of the Year Awards, where you had to get on crutches 3 times up to accept awards, and I wasn't sure you were going to make it back on any one of those 3 occasions. And I went back to Australia and said, I'm very sad to have to say it, I don't think Richard will be back, and yet here you are. You've just gone through a couple more absolute triumphs.
Well, it was quite extraordinary because I'd just come out of plaster when you'd seen me 2 weeks early, and we took grave risks to get the foot moving again and working, and it took me 8 weeks of hard work to get fit. And I wasn't even selected in the original 12 to play against India at Christchurch, but I was included in the 13 to be a net bowler and for the selectors to see just what sort of condition I was in. And Willie Watson actually broke a thumb just prior to that test match, and I was drafted in as his replacement. And I played in that match with having 30 overs behind me in club cricket. And so I got on the field, got the 4 wickets, we won that particular match, the 400 came up, which was a tremendous milestone. In fact, I received 400 roses to mark the occasion they came out onto the field. And we won that particular series, and which again was important, but it meant that I'd gone through the 70s and the 80s, and I'd started the 90s in a New Zealand cricket team. So I was going into sort of 3 decades of cricket, and it was a marvellous feeling to still be part of that New Zealand team again against the odds.
What was the feeling when you got that 400th?
Well, the first 3 wickets actually came very quickly in the first innings, and then I was left on 399, and it wasn't until the second innings and late, or midway through their second innings, that wicket came about. And Sanjay Mandrake becomes that particular victim. I think the Indians were having a sweepstake as to who the 400th would be, but he actually got an inside edge onto the stumps. And I must admit that when it happened, there was great joy, obviously, but one of relief, because I've had a habit when I've needed milestones anywhere around the world, which seemingly should happen reasonably quickly, have been delayed somewhat through whatever circumstance. But certainly it was a very special moment.
Let's just have a look now at the second test match at Lord's, where you have the privilege of leading out the New Zealand team.
That was a magnificent strike, a very strong player. only made one when he faced that ball. That's a better shot, if anything. It wasn't all that short. And I suspect it may have been the top spinner as well. He's given that plenty. This is good fun. Not for Gladson Small, I guess, but certainly in the commentary box and sitting around the ground, there's plenty to enjoy. That's a cracking shot. Lovely shot off the back foot. No need to chase it.
In the slightest amount of room, and he'll make a little bit more for himself. The crowd love it. No need for anybody to move for that. Certainly not Hadlee. Four more. It is exactly the sort of innings that John Wright wanted. And New Zealand, what they think of it, and the crowd. And a splendid innings in what's probably his last appearance with the bat on this ground.
To Richard Hadlee on 50.
A magnificent stroke off the back foot. He really does give that ball some stick.
And that's tucked away again. Tucked one bounce for four. One of a natural eye. It was very short, but it did bounce a bit. It's in the gap. It's in the gap, it's just a flick. What timing! A crippling bit of fielding, that. It middled him on the shins. It still went for four. It was only the sprint by Devon Malcolm got the blood going again.
Gooch has a chase there. Even though Hadlee didn't quite get that off the meat of the bat, it has gone away at a terrific rate up the hill. Hadlee goes to 81, New Zealand go to 402. This afternoon's entertainment has been magnificent. That's beaten Devon Malcolm. That's a beautiful shot by Richard Hadlee. Disappointed with that, but I had the feeling that he'd set himself in this game just after he'd been knighted, that he'd motivated himself. If New Zealand couldn't win the game, that a century was there for the taking. So Eddie Hemmings deserves the wicket. He flighted that up, gave Hadlee the chance to hit, and now a marvellous ovation for Richard Hadlee.
Asking and given, Robin Smith knew. A little circle that not many caught and bowls Hadlee gets, but that was one that ballooned back off the pad. There was some bat on it there. Hadlee was never in doubt.
Oh, what a wonderful catch. Superb catch. Lightning reflexes off the middle of the bat, and Jack Russell must have expected runs. And now he's back in close to the stumps. Change of line, beautiful bowling. Classic piece of bowling. And Chris Lewis goes caught behind the wickets for one.
That is very comprehensive, and the new bat did little good. Perhaps it simply wasn't wide enough. OBW, and will that be a wicket for Richard Hadlee with his last ball in Test cricket? To join a very select group of players who have done that. The end of England's second innings with the score at 158. So it's a great performance from New Zealand. They have to make 345 to win. That was Plum. Another five in innings for Richard Hadlee.
The wicket with your last ball, what sort of a thrill was that?
Yes, it was a great thrill. I mean, I came here to England very relaxed. I wasn't obsessional, I wasn't chasing anything. In fact, there was some doubt as though I'd actually come on this tour. And I wanted to play and be as competitive as I could, but to enjoy myself on this tour. And I started the series pretty well at Trent Bridge there with a wicket in the first ball that I bowled to Graham Gooch. And I ended the series with the last ball that I bowled with a wicket as well. The knighthood came about. John Wright asked me to lead the side onto the field at Lord's, the home of cricket, of course, to play a swashbuckling innings the way I like to play at Lord's was a special moment. Obviously sad to leave the field at Edgbaston, knowing that we'd lost the match and the series, but still an enjoyable series. But I can look back and say that I'm very happy, very contented with what's happened during my career. And irrespective of what I've been able to achieve in the game, if I can be remembered for the way that I've played the game, where I've played it hard, I like to think I've been fair and entertained. And I think that sports people do have an obligation to the paying public. And if I can be remembered for that, more than for what I've achieved, then that to me is far more important.
Richard, thank you very much indeed. A very happy retirement to you and to Lady Hadlee. We look forward to the next chapter and the next video.